So, this is the introduction to the AI conversation basics unit in this course, in this short AI course. So the concept of this one is we are trying to, maybe I should get this little panel up there, pop filter, pop, pop. We are trying to get you doing something useful with conversational AI. You know, we talked before about why this is such a strange and wild new trend. Now we want to talk about, like, how can you actually use it in your day-to-day? And the basic idea is virtually all modern work is some kind of... Whoops, I keep doing that. No matter what I'm doing. All modern work, not all, right? But, like, so much of modern work that we all do is some form of knowledge work. And if you're a student, you are a maximum knowledge worker. That is primarily what you are doing in this environment. If you're a professor, you are also maximally a knowledge worker. So AI systems like this are built almost exclusively to support knowledge work, right? They have to do with understanding data, understanding language, understanding knowledge, understanding databases, understanding, you know, that the goal of these tools is to get to a place where they are very knowledgeable and can provide lots of support. And the most common form of AI you will interact with for the foreseeable, which is not very far away, but for the moment, is conversational AI, right? This natural language interface of getting things done. So we're working just with text right now, just conversational prompting, essentially chatting, right? Just sitting down and getting started from scratch. I'm not like giving you specific special prompts to work with, just these are things you can just do with any of these AI models that are sufficiently clever. So let's look at how to quickly do useful knowledge work using conversational AI. So first, some guiding thoughts, and this is a good quote that sticks with me. Let me take some of my afternoon coffee. Any task that can be automated is a waste of human intellect, right? Buckminster Fuller. So the point is not automate every single thing, do nothing, and have no role in the task, right? That's the way that you see people using the baseline ChatGPT to extremely poor effect. It's the please do my homework for me, mommy mentality of how to use these tools. And I'm quoting myself, this is extremely stupid. It's how you get caught cheating. It's how you don't use the tool for something useful. You just use it to excuse your own, you know, not producing work. That's the kind of thing that you've been warned against. That's not what you're doing here. You are using this tool to automate portions of your knowledge worker workflow, your pipeline. Whatever you're doing, there is some staging that happens. There is some order of operations that need to happen for you to produce a useful essay or a project website or something, right? And really what the parts that you want to automate in this scenario are things that you already grasp pretty well and things that you're comfortable delegating to someone else, right? And furthermore, even if it's a task that you're not really sure everything that you're doing, that doesn't mean that you have to, you don't only have to use AI to do things you already are slam dunking. You can explore with it, right? And one of the reasons that's so really possible with these systems is any task, even if it's way above your head, can be decomposed into simpler subtasks. And at some point, the task becomes trivial enough that you can probably feel comfortable delegating it, right? You might not have it write an entire essay for you, but you might be able to figure out, well, okay, I could have it write the intro, right? And intro paragraph. And because you already kind of know what you're looking for out of an intro paragraph, you're trying to set the stage. You're trying to provide some inputs and some ways of thinking about whatever your topic's going to be, right? That's just one example of many. So the idea being that, yeah, you don't want it to write your entire paper for you and then not check it, not do anything additional. But there are elements of whatever knowledge work you're doing that this thing can help you with. In addition, I forgot to write down here, so keep it in mind, is you also can use it to explore new topics, and you can use it to, so let's say you're trying to do something and you're not really sure where to start. You can use it to help you figure out where to start, or help you figure out the next step, or help you figure out from your own knowledge, what's the next thing I need to learn in order to become better at this tool, at this process, etc. This all assumes that the system knows what the process is, but with these new models, starting with GPT-4, that's less of a fear, I suppose. The more you use it, the more you start to see it really can do a lot of these basic things pretty well, and it can show you a lot of options. So that's some guiding thoughts. And now let's just talk about some things to consider. This will be the first video. There will be several other sub-videos. I've already recorded one, and I'll be recording several that will, you know, demonstrate a specific conversation pattern that we can get into. So things to consider going into the conversation with the AI. I've done it again. Ugh, so annoying. Maximize group. Control K, I guess. Control K. Control M. 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 No, that brought up a different robot. Control K. Nope. Oh well. Here, I'm still human. I'm not just a video. Okay. So, things to consider when you sit down with this blank chat fella. The first is, like, what are you trying to do, right? And you can refine this as the conversation progresses. You don't have to have an extremely well-defined goal, but you always have some reason that you're starting a conversation, right? Even if it's just to mess around and see what the robot can do. So having your goal in mind and explicitly communicating it to the system will help set its like domain, right? That's a lot of what we're doing here. We are trying to set it up in a way that it will gravitate towards the kinds of answers we want, because if you don't give it very much, it's going to give you generic stuff, boring stuff, average stuff. The more specific you get, the more it can help you be more specific yourself, and the more it can really get you on track to something that you really want, and not just the generic sort of Google-esque encyclopedic answers that it tends to give. So, what do you want out of the conversation? That's the goal. Context. The more context you can give it about whatever you're trying to do today, the better. What are you trying to achieve? Oh my god, every friggin' time. What are you trying to achieve? What's your current understanding or skill set? Do you have any additional details? Like, let's say you were trying to craft a statement of purpose for a grad school letter, right? The more of your own like knowledge you lay on the table with the system, the more you include that during the conversation, the better it'll get at understanding. You can also give it things like your own style to emulate. Like, hey, I like to talk in this way. I don't prefer this. You can give it more and more pieces of information around the thing you're trying to create or the thing you're trying to achieve, and it will make it better and better. So the more context, the better. So have an explicit goal. The more context, the better. Roles. You can say how you want to be treated. For example, treat me like a generally skilled programmer, but a novice web developer, right? This is a powerful series of words for helping anyone. That would help a human figure out where to start with you, right? That's kind of what we're doing here. You are trying to impart enough information that anyone, AI or person, would be able to get you quickly to what you're looking for, right? If you just sat down and said, oh, well, teach me web dev, I would probably start from, well, okay, here's what variables are. But if then you're like, no, I have 10 years of Java experience, I just haven't done any web dev yet, I would start from a completely different place, right? So keep that mirroring in mind, keep that perspective in mind of what would you need to be able to give good answers to someone. Give that to the system. You can also ask it, act as a seasoned professional in the field of marketing and give me feedback on my website design ideas or something, because it's read a lot of that content. You know, it has read the internet, recall, and so it has a lot of knowledge about various domains and fields and things that have been published, things that have been written, comments on websites. Everywhere that it was able to pull information from, it has absorbed it. Does that mean it's always going to give you the best advice? Of course not. You are still responsible for the way that the tool guides you, right? But it does give you a great deal of new perspectives. It can say, like, for example, if you're job hunting, it can take on the role of a recruiter and say, well, here's what a recruiter would probably be looking for in this field that you're trying to get a job in, right? It can turn around and give you new input from a new perspective. Giving it examples. So if you're trying to build something specific, right, you want a specific type of output, like, say, statement of purpose, letter of recommendation, a what's another, like, obvious thing, like resume, right? You might have a particular shape that you want it to look like. You might have an example resume that, hey, I really like this one, let me give you the text of this one and help me structure it around it. It's extremely good at following examples, and it's great at it. Just one example of whatever you're trying to do will be powerful. Two will be even more powerful, right? After that, you don't need too many more, but a couple of examples of whatever you're doing. I didn't finish that. I don't care. So give it a specific template, for example. That will help it. If you want it to respond in a very specific way, like, let's say you want it to respond, hey, take my loose thoughts and turn them into notes. If you just say notes, it might kind of interpret that 100 different ways. If you give it a very specific shape of the notes, like a schema of, hey, here's the topic and here are 3 sub-bullets. I want that for everything that I'm saying, right? Topic and 3 sub-bullets. Then it will follow that much more closely, right? So any examples you can give, powerful. Good stuff. Formatting. You can ask for kind of basically anything as long as it's text, right? So that could be Markdown, it could be any programming language, it could be HTML or CSS, it can be, you know, just raw text if you want. And a nice way to also do this for your own sake is asking for things inside of a code fence. So let's say, give me a quick rundown of the features of a dog in a Markdown format inside a code fence. And dog features, physical characteristics, fur, hair, blah, 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 blah. There it goes, running off, giving us way too much detail, which is fine. You know, it does what it can. So that's an example. I could have been doing more of these, but it's fine. I think these have made sense until then. Interaction. So the more you interact with the system during the conversation, the better it'll become. Hey, can we make that shorter? This is for younger students, and it's going into an infographic, so less wordy, right? You see what I've done here? I've added more context, and we've boiled it down, right? It took its long form stuff it was doing above and put them into a much shorter form. Now, senses, great smell, interesting way to frame that. So you might still want to edit, but so the interaction, right? The more you do, the more things will start to evolve here. So another bit is progress capture. So this is something, it's important to recognize that the conversation can get a little long in tooth. The longer you chat with the AI, the more stuff is just kind of in the chat history, especially if you're doing something like brainstorming, right? Where you're like, okay, let's generate lots of ideas and let's chase certain ones specifically. The discarded ideas that the system will have put out, or even you might have dropped in and you said, actually, let's change our minds, they're still going to be there. And they're still going to be in the context history. And while it's pretty dang good at making sure it follows what your goals are now, and not just from the full history, the longer it gets, the more sort of, like, confused it can get. I've often had things where I'll be working on lecture notes, and I'll be sort of just doing a verbal dump, and I'll be like, wait, let's start over. You should probably just start a new conversation in that scenario, not keep going, because when you keep going, what happened to me was old slides would start getting re-swept up into the summaries, and it was gradually becoming more and more incoherent. So progress capture is huge. You want to ask for summaries or partial drafts of whatever you're doing, chunks of documents, things that you can take elsewhere and use later. You can edit them, that kind of stuff, right? You're trying to get the draft. So if you're having a brainstorming session occasionally, every time I double click, why do I always double click? Oh, because I'm trying to select the whole word. Okay. So a list of ideas brainstormed, right? You might every so often while you're doing a brainstorming session or after it feels like you've done enough, ask it for a list of the ideas, kind of boil down into bullets like we're talking about here, right? Let's brainstorm ideas on how to write this infographic. Can you sketch out a few HTML shapes this could take and describe them? So, you know, the idea is that you can get pieces that can be used later. So, for example, here, we're doing a little bit of progress capture where it's showing here's one structure that it described for us, and we can now take this and run it and see what it does, right? Do we like this? Is this a good starting point for us? Or should we maybe examine the next one? Should we look at this infographic? Should we look at this infographic? Whatever it is, right? Oh, this one has tabs. It's a tabbed system for the infographic. Cool. Other things, and then this is just kind of other examples, but lists of critiques leveraged by the AI, right? You might have a website design and you want it to be critiqued. You take the whole HTML, you just dump it right in there and say, hey, what do you think could be improved? Look at this from the perspective of a seasoned web developer, right? Sections of a document, right? Like, let's say you're working on one specific... I keep screwing that up. I think I'll never learn at this point. section of a document you're trying to draft, right? Say you're working on a section of your resume. You want to beef up your experience section of your resume, and maybe you're not sure what really counts. So you can say, hey, take on the role of a recruiter specifically in the field I'm looking at, and help me figure out what are the things that are useful. And it can help you write that section. It can help you dump out pieces of that section that look a little bit better, right? And it'll still be based on your own experience, but it will be a chunk of text that is a little bit better formatted for things like, you know, advertising yourself to a particular role in a particular field. Lists of questions that you want to ask later, right? So if you're in a real early planning stages of a project and you have a lot of things that you want to start charting what's possible. Collect those questions, save them. That's the goal here, right? Progress capture is all about, you know, the conversations cannot go forever, and you need to be starting new ones regularly to keep it kind of clean. And the questions, or not the questions, the things that you're doing, you want to be able to save something, right? You want to capture something out so that you can then use it later, or even just feed it back into a different chat. But the idea is, You gotta work on banking progress. The outline of a document, that's a great one. Like, you can say, hey, I'm working on this YouTube video I wanna write, and I'm trying to figure out what order to do things in and where the transition should go and blah, blah, blah. It can help you sketch out a document outline. And you can take that outline and save it somewhere. Keep track of it for later. The same way you would have outlined it yourself, capture it out. You know, don't just leave everything trapped inside an infinite conversation that ultimately you're honestly, based on my experience, you're going to forget about. I have had so many experiences where I have done something really cool with the AI and had a good conversation and like had a good voice back and forth. Like, oh yeah, let's plan three different assignments for a course right now. We got ideas. And I do, and I'm all excited. And then they just kind of fade into the chat history because I didn't capture anything out. They're still there. But by the time I sit down to do it again, I would rather just start fresh, and that's not really the vibe, right? So to be productive, you gotta work on your progress capture. So you ask, okay, hey, can you give me something that I can take with me from this conversation? So to recap that real quick, you gotta have a goal going in, and you wanna have some kind of output to use. You gotta keep interacting. You can provide formats for it to work with. You can provide examples for it to work around. You can ask it to behave in particular ways and to treat you in particular ways. And the more context you can give about whatever you're working on, the better it's going to be. So With that, I wanted to just drop this kind of framing for a good general way to think about your conversations with AI. And that is, what role do you want it to play, right? Let's say, in this sense, it is your conversation partner, right? And the question is, what kind of knowledge worker do you want your conversation partner to be when you're sitting down to be productive? Now, you don't always have to tell it, you're my brainstorming partner, but it's good to think about, what role are you trying to get it to fill such that you can have a good productive conversation? One of the main ones I use all the time is transcriber, which is, hey, I'm going to start talking and I would like it if you could clean that up and turn it into notes or a slide, like a basic rough draft of slides or into a rough draft of an assignment for a course or whatever. A big verbal dump, I want to be talking to a transcriber. So I want to make sure that the way that I engage in the conversation initially is all about, hey, here's what you're up to. Here's what I would like you to do. Please transcribe this for me. Or tutor. I have it tutor me on all kinds of stuff. Hey, I did it again. She's really howling because they're possibly me. Tutor. I'm similar to what I described above. I've done a lot of web development in my life and done a lot of programming in my life, but I never launched like a full stack app, for example. And Cognate, this one over here, this app, is a full stack app. And the way I got to that was by saying, hey, I've done a little bit of web dev before. I taught students about Vue and like Bootstrap, and I'm pretty decent with JavaScript and HTML and CSS. And I would like to build this app using Vue, and I've never done anything in Node. I've never deployed to a server and launched, you know, bought a web domain and done all this stuff. And it just pleasantly guided me straight from nothing, gradually one step at a time towards success. Now, was that one conversation? No, it was hundreds of conversations. It was me taking different chunks of what I was working on. And when I wasn't quite sure what direction I wanted to move in exactly, like I wasn't sure the next step, but I did know the next sort of overall sub-goal, I could describe that. I would describe to the system like, hey, I've got this working. Here's a big chunk of my code as it exists. Now help me figure out what function should I add to make this thing happen, or what package should I import? I'm not very well versed in the package ecosystem for this. Now, again, it's not always perfect. It won't always give you perfect answers on these things because it has outdated information. It's only trained up through like last year, 2023, I think. But it will still help guide you. And it will. And even if it just suggests the wrong package, that's fine. At least now you know that packages exist that do the thing you want. So all kinds of things. It can be your paired programmer. Some of my friends use it as a therapy coach. Now, that's a little bit in the Eliza effect territory. Eliza, the original therapy chatbot, look her up. But really it can be useful because a lot of therapy is really just mechanical motions of getting you to reflect on something, right? Or getting you to interrupt a thought pattern. And having a tool that can help you get to those quickly without having to like schedule an appointment with a therapist is pretty useful. Critic, like I said before, you can have it assess things from different perspectives. One thing that I do often is like, I'll say, hey, here's my web page. Here's the web layout. Can you assess this from like a super pedestrian standpoint, a seasoned developer standpoint, a UI engineer standpoint, and like a UX person? You know, these different patterns, now you're getting four different perspectives. Now, do they perfectly represent those fields? Maybe, maybe not. But it's still working. It's still a working question set. It asks you questions that are within the realm of possibility of, you know, of being realistic. So it can help you with task decomposition. If you have something you're trying to work on, but you're not sure where to start, you can have it break that task down into sub-steps. Paired programmer, that's what I've been using it for a lot. I will make something and I'll say, hey, can you help me figure out how to add this feature? And it will either do it or it'll instruct me on what the steps are. Paper editor, give it the text of your paper and say, how would you reorganize this? It doesn't flow very well. And you can have it start on it. You can have it write per little example bits. You can have it demonstrate why one thing flows versus the other. It can do all those things within the context of it serving as a paper editor. Interviewer, that's a good pattern. That's where you get it to ask you a bunch of questions, right? You take a back seat and you let it prompt you. Reading companion, you say, hey, I'm having trouble comprehending a lot of this text. Can you help me sort of like, here's a bunch of text. Can you break it down a little bit and give me some basics? Help me understand some of the context behind this. Help me understand cultural histories hidden behind the author who is from blank or whatever, right? PR agent, information desk helper, exploratory consultant. So project manager, that's also task decomposition. These are all different roles that you might have somebody help you out with in these capacities, right? That's the way you should think about collaborating with an AI system is, hey, I need a transcriber right now. I need a tutor right now. And it's going to be infinitely patient. It will ask you, you know, it will try to help as much as it can. It's really dedicated to helping out. So this is the basics. This is the sort of baseline for what we're doing today in this unit. And that puts us in a good spot to shove off and get you into more specific examples.
Right.
See you there.